Misdirection by Barbara Serenella. They gave her a code name to keep her safe, they said. And then they stuck her in a 6x9 cell with the coldest-blooded murderer to ever do time in the Corona Institute for Women, keeping in mind that this was the same facility where the Manson family girls would grow old and toothless and eventually die. 007, they dubbed her. Her mission was to get her cellie to talk, to brag, to confide. The FBI agents sat with her in the warden's office and showed her photographs of murdered people. They had been killed in a variety of ways. Hit people, unlike serial killers, didn't have signature styles. That would be stupid and incriminating. 007 paused at one particularly gory shot of a murdered Latino man. His nose was jammed flat so that the two bloody nostrils were on the same plane as the lifeless eyes. The feds explained that the cartilage had been forced into the brain, that even if the victim had survived, he would be unable to recount who had done this to him. "And this is who you want me to buddy up to and then betray?" 007 asked. "We'll have your cell bugged," Agent Arnaz said. He was a nice enough seeming guy, 007 thought. She would never have made him for a fed. He seemed more like a minister in one of those churches where the ministers wore street clothes and got to get married if he wanted. "Yeah," 007 said, wiping her sweating hands on the legs of her jeans. "But what about if she attacks me somewhere else?" "We'll be watching," Agent Bowler said. He was a thin guy, kind of geeky looking. He reminded her of a first-year public defender. Nervous, like one of those young lawyers who the court appoints, and right away you know he's in way over his head, and that, with your courtroom experience and 10th-grade education, you could still do a better job of defending yourself than him. She turned to Arnaz. "And what do I get out of all this?" "The satisfaction of keeping a monster off the street." "So she can be in here with the rest of us monsters." Arnaz acknowledged her sarcasm with a small smile. His younger partner hadn't developed a sense of humor yet, probably thought smiling at a criminal was a sign of weakness. "You'll also get a favorable report at your next parole hearing," Arnaz said, correctly assessing what she wanted to hear. "Is there a reward?" she asked. "You know, like money?" "Don't push it," Bowler said. He took a sip of his Starbucks coffee and looked smug. 007 wanted to ask him who died and made him King Law. Though, in truth, she preferred young cops with egos. They were so much easier to manipulate. "All right," she said. "How are we going to pull this off?" The warden, who had been quiet until now, took over. Like the other inmates, 007 was always polite to the guy, but only minimally. He had a thin mustache, a pot belly, and a comb-over. He looked like the kind of guy who took forever to come and never tipped. "I'm issuing a facility-wide reassignment of cells and cellmates," he said now, twisting the ends of his mustache into small rat tails. "That way, your reassignment won't stand out." "Good thinking, sir," she said. She was escorted back to her cell block, what the COs euphemistically termed the dorms. CIW was said to have a college campus layout. There was a whole lot of learning going on, that was for sure. Mostly cons trading tips. Her escort was Officer Jesus, or so they called her behind her back. To her face, she was Officer Dwan. And at the prayer meeting she was always holding, inmates were encouraged to call her Sister Dwan. Her mission on Earth, Dwan believed, was to save sinners from eternal damnation by getting them to accept Jesus. What the hell? 007 thought. At least her heart was in the right place. The following day, Cass and Trinity were put together. Each did the appropriate grumbling at the interruption of their routine and living arrangement. But there really was no point in it. When you were inside, you gave up any sort of freedom of choice of where to be, when to be there, and what to do once you were there. Cass was the older of the two. She kept her hair cropped close to her head and might have been pretty in the right circumstances. A scar ran down the length of her face from the corner of her right eye to her jaw. It wasn't disfiguring and could be hidden by makeup. She didn't bother with flesh-toned paste and powder while on the inside. This sometimes led to questions about how she got the scar in the first place. She never answered those queries. In fact, she rarely answered anyone's questions. She barely said 5 words to Trinity the first day. That was okay with Trinity. She wasn't in a particularly sharing mood either. Always best to start off slow with a new roomie. If nothing else, to at least give the illusion of each woman having her own space. Trinity's people were from the Dominican Republic. She was a mocha-skinned Amazon with wavy black hair, high cheekbones, and a winning smile when she chose to use it. Both women were healthy after their prolonged, if unintentional, abstinence from their various poisons. Both were buff, their muscles well-toned from the fire crew training regimen. Firefighting was a good job, even when it meant clearing brush in the hot sun or picking up garbage. The detail got them out of the facility, away from the smell of cow piss from the neighboring dairy farms and the usual harassments that went along with prison life. There were still guards, but the inmates were treated with respect by the people of the different communities. They could also count on some decent eats while they were out in the wilderness fighting brush fires. On the second night of their new living arrangement, after lights were out and lockdown, Trinity lay awake. The floodlights outside their opaque window lit the cell like dawn. There wasn't much to see. A stainless steel toilet with no lid, an equally austere sink, 2 upright storage lockers with no locks, a small writing table with a fixed seat. She missed movable parts and colors. If the cell were tipped upside down, nothing would move except the thin mattresses on their bunk beds. She listened to Cass breathe on the pallet beneath her. The other woman's respirations didn't follow the irregularity of sleep. The intake and exhales were too measured. After a half hour, she broke the silence. "So, what you in for?" "A miscommunication," Cass said, not pretending that she had been asleep. Trinity chuckled deep in her throat. "I've met the bitch myself a few times." "What about you?" Cass asked. "Zigging, when I should have zagged." Cass responded with a grunt that was her excuse for a laugh and went to sleep. Agent Bowler removed his earphones and shook his head in disgust. "Man," he said to his partner, "at this rate it's going to take forever." Agent Arness took a sip of his coffee, but seemed unperturbed. 007 is playing it smart, taking her time. She might just make it. Agent Bowler didn't respond to that. He didn't like talking about past failures. After a moment, he mumbled, "Nah, I don't trust her. That's all I'm saying." Arness, halfway through another sip of his black coffee, had to spit what was in his mouth back into the white styrofoam cup to make room for his laugh. "Trust her?" he chuckled, wagging his head in amusement. "Of course we don't trust her. She's a con, for Christ's sakes."